But let's move on for right now, at least to the state of the COVID crisis itself, with the amount of cases surging across the country. Obviously, a lot to talk about, specifically with the types of communities that have been disproportionately impacted across this country. We have with us Dr. James Hildreth. He is head of the Meharry Medical College and the CEO and president there. Dr. Hildreth, thank you so much for joining us this morning. I wanted to ask you, you've again been focused on kind of who's been affected during the midst of this crisis. As we've seen that surge go up in the course of the winter, have those communities continued to be disproportionately impacted? And what types of obstacles will that present as we look towards that vaccine and just the public knowledge of how to get vaccinated and what that might mean for a society in the United States here in 2021?
Thank you for having me. Unfortunately, the disparities and inequities and the burden of disease from COVID-19 has not changed. Minority communities, communities of color, are still being disproportionately impacted by the pandemic. One of my major concerns is that those communities that need the vaccine the most are among those who are most resistant or hesitant to accept the vaccine. So one of our major challenges as we move forward is to try to dispel the myths and make those communities more accepting of the vaccine. And that's what we're trying to do as we speak.
Dr. Hildreth, how do you convince minority populations that this vaccine is safe? Because we hear time and time again that unless 75 to 80% of our population receives this vaccine, we're not going to achieve herd immunity. So what specifically can these communities do to get people vaccinated?
So the first thing we have to do is to acknowledge that there is a reasonable rationale for the hesitancy and the mistrust that goes all the way back, in my opinion, to 1619. So the first thing is to acknowledge that there is a basis for the hesitation. The next thing is we have to identify trusted messengers. This is something I learned from my work in HIV, that in trying to develop prevention messages to get communities to protect themselves, the messages were fine, but unless the messengers were trusted, they were not very impactful. So we have to identify trusted messengers, opinion leaders, and get them comfortable with accepting the vaccines and have them be the ones to engage the community. And that's the approach that we're taking in terms of COVID-19 vaccines.
Dr. Hildreth, I'm Julie here. Good to speak with you again. I know that we've had so many discussions this year about the health disparities. It's come into the fore in a way that we've never talked about before. And I have been personally watching just how much more broadly in the mainstream this topic has been covered. But it's something that you've been watching for a while. And I want to know, you know, we've seen the administration sort of be forced to take on this role of talking about it, to your point of validating and discussing the issues like the Tuskegee experiment, like going back to older experiments that have been done. But can this momentum be sustained? And what is needed in order to continue this into the new administration?
Well, thank you. I do believe it can be sustained. And one of the things that gives me a lot of hope is large organizations, both public and private, are taking up this mantle to try to make some significant changes. And to me, that gives me hope that we will, that the pandemic will lead to some substantive changes in how we think about health in this country. And as a reminder, we spend $3.5 trillion a year on healthcare, but we're not even in the top 10 of the healthiest countries. So we gotta think about how we're spending those dollars in terms of prevention, the wellness of young children, especially the habits they develop when they're young. So I'm hopeful, really, really hopeful that the pandemic, as bad as it is, will lead to some really substantial changes in how we think about health and view health equity as a national priority rather than an afterthought, which I think has been the case for quite some time. So I'm very encouraged.
Well, that's good to hear. Let's hope it works out. Pivoting really quickly to the vaccine, I heard you on the VRBPAC meeting, especially talking about the supply of the vaccine and the shortages, the limited supply there, and being able to use them with consideration to individuals who've already had the virus. Is there any more clarity on that right now?
So the real question that we were debating in the VRBPAC meeting was whether or not the placebo recipients should now be offered the vaccine. And in my opinion, it would be unethical to not offer them the vaccine, since they're the very ones who made it possible for us to have the vaccine in the first place. So the compromise will be to do a blinded crossover. So those who got the vaccine will get a placebo, those who got the placebo will get the vaccine. That way the trial can go to completion of 2 years. We'll get some very valuable information about length of protection, more data about safety. But from my perspective, we've taken a population approach to the pandemic to this point, which assumes that the risk is even across the population. It is certainly not the same across the population, which means a more focused approach will be appropriate. And I think that the distribution of the vaccine should be based on those who need it the most. And that would be healthcare providers, of course, those in assisted living facilities, and minority communities that have such a high burden of disease that makes them more susceptible to disease and death. So that is what I'm hoping will happen. And I think that the CDC committee that's making recommendations about distribution, that's their focus as well. So again, I'm encouraged that in contrast to responding to the pandemic itself, plans for distributing the vaccine are as they should be. And I'm really excited about that.
And Dr. Hildreth, I guess maybe just to clarify, if you're talking about those that got the placebo, I think maybe what Anjali was trying to get at was, what about people that have had COVID-19 already? Let's say, for example, they had shown symptoms. Should those people, would they be allowed to maybe skip one dose? Could they? What's, I guess, the approach in the operations here for those people?
Yes. So I'm sorry. The point is that people who get infected can be reinfected, which means that the immune response they have made is not adequate to confer protection. But the way the immune response works, the first time you see something you've not seen before, you make a primary response to it, which in most cases is not adequate for protection. The next time you see that, you make a secondary response, and is orders of magnitude greater than a primary response. So the idea would be that if you've already been infected by COVID-19, you have made a primary response. So a single injection of the vaccine may be sufficient to induce a secondary response and confer protection. And if that were the case, the tens of millions of people who have already been infected might need a single dose versus two doses, and that would make the vaccine go much further. That was the point I was trying to make in the meeting.
All right. Thanks so much for clarifying that, Dr. James Hildreth of Meharry Medical College. Thanks for being with us.